During 2006, James Turner, Jeffery Bernard, Caleb Lesher, and myself, Eric Stackpole, designed and assembled a series of small hybrid rocket motors made entirely out of parts from a local hardware store. We used James' garage as a shop and test facility, and were able to assemble everything using only basic tools. The first step to making a hybrid rocket motor was to achieve sustainable combustion of the solid fuel using liquid or gas oxidizer. In this case, we used pieces of polyethylene tubing inserted into an open-ended aluminum cylinder.
There it is.
A copper pipe attached to one end of the cylinder supplied gaseous oxygen to the system from a disposable tank intended for oxyacetylene welding kits. In this test, no nozzle was attached to the other end of the cylinder, as we were purely interested in getting a sustainable flame. After establishing good techniques for burning the polyethylene, we began making very simple nozzles from brass end caps. A variety of such nozzles were crafted and tested to gain a better understanding for how various geometries affected each burn.
Yeah. Nice cover.
Woo!
All right. Test 17.
17.
During our 17th test, we accomplished our first real rocket flame. Here, one can see the external flame retire into the rocket body, where pressure is built up enough for rapid combustion to occur. In the short time that the rocket was firing in this state, the brass nozzle heated so rapidly that it began to decompose, throwing sparks across the room. After several successful tests with rapid combustion, we decided to begin testing with actual nozzle geometries rather than just pinholes. These shapes were made by dremeling into the head of a steel end cap. To meet thermal expansion properties and increase strength, a steel pipe was also used for the rocket body in place of brass. Two plywood walls were mounted on either side of the rocket as a basic means for protection from ejected debris. Finally, a camera was mounted looking at the rocket from above so that shock diamonds, indicators of the supersonic exhaust velocity, might be seen. Due to the brightness of the flame, this effect was not visible on the video. However, shock diamonds were definitely apparent while watching the rocket closely. Note the smoke vortexing around the nozzle as the rocket fires. Several seconds after ignition, the flame was briefly interrupted by a pop. It turned out that this is the result of ejecting a large piece of polyethylene fuel, which was later found wrapped around the corner of a freezer across the room, some 30 feet downrange of the nozzle. We became curious about how much thrust was being produced by our rocket, and decided to build a test stand using drawer rollers that would allow the rocket to push against someone's hand, or that could be attached to a sort of scale. In this test, no scale was attached, but a basic idea of thrust was obtained by feel. If desired, a specific value of thrust could be obtained by measuring the weight of the rocket cart and multiplying that by the acceleration seen in the video across the attached yardstick. We later attached a fish scale to one end of the wire fixed to the rocket cart. The results were inconclusive because the fish scale did not render values quickly enough to get a good reading. It was estimated that the rocket produced around 5 pounds of thrust. After more than 20 tests using polyethylene, we decided to begin experimentation with a new fuel. Several hybrid rocket motors we had heard about used common roofing tar as a fuel, and we decided that this would be the best next step. To construct the rocket, a steel pipe was positioned in the center of the rocket body, and molten tar was poured around it. After the tar had hardened, the entire assembly was put into a freezer to further harden the tar and construct a center pipe. The pipe was then hammered out of the tar cylinder, leaving an open hole running down the rocket to deliver oxygen to the fuel. Just as with polyethylene rockets, an oxidizer manifold was attached to one end of the rocket tube, and the nozzle was attached to the other end. Despite having a new fuel, you could never have expected the rocket to have this much power. It was immediately apparent that the power produced by the tar rocket required some sort of protective barrier for safe operation. We began drawing plans for a plywood and sand enclosure that would be capable of absorbing shrapnel should the rocket body eject parts or explode during a test. The resulting enclosure was made of an 8-inch thick wall that could be filled with sand. With our new enclosure and an eagerness to move forward, plans for bigger and more advanced rockets started to come together.